Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Professor Grabowski, thank you much for meeting me here. On behalf of International Relations Daily and Institute of Assembly, I would like to extend our thank you for doing this interview with us. Today we'll talk about North Korea, the quite interesting situation there, and how the international community will react towards the situation in this country. Just to introduce Professor Grabowski, he doesn't need introduction, but still for our broader audiences, I would like to say that Professor Grabowski has been associated with Jagiellonian University for the last 7 or 9 years, or even more. In an academic capacity, I suppose it is around 7 or 8 years. As a student, he graduated a master's at local Institute of American Studies, and he also finished his PhD here. He studied also on a number of exchanges, Columbia University, George Washington University in Washington, University of California, where he finished a global leadership program. So thank you very much for accepting our invitation again. And Professor Grabowski, just as a matter of introduction, could you tell me about your Institute of ASEM, about your process of becoming a professor? What led you there?
I'm still an assistant professor, it's been an ongoing process. If I would to give like a broader story of myself, a lot of things happened accidentally. I've started my studies at an IR program, International Relations, more than 10 years ago. And same year when I started my studies, I started to learn Chinese. There was some instructors from China teaching at our university at the time. It drew my attention towards this part of the world, and then my MA thesis was to be written about relations between the United States and China as I got deeper interested in the Asia-Pacific region. For this sake, I was lucky, as you've mentioned, to go to the Columbia University in New York, where they had East Asian Institute. And as my supervisor from Columbia went to sabbatical at the time, I had the pleasure to work with two other very prominent professors. One was Andrew Naden, and he's specialist on Chinese issues. So collaborating with him, I was deepening my interest and my research project about relations between the United States and China. At the same time, I got this, I would say, second supervisor, a person who took care about me, was Professor Hugh Patrick. Hugh Patrick was still being a co-director of APEC Study Center within the Columbia Business School, and he was also director of the Center for Japanese Economy and Business at Columbia Business School. As a co-director of APEC Study Center, but one of the founding fathers of APEC, he again drew my attention to more multilateral IR. In Poland, we tended to concentrate more on bilateral issues. Apart from European Union, that was a hot topic at that time. But in the US, I got more oriented or reoriented towards APEC. As I've mentioned, Professor Hugh Patrick, together with Professor Peter Dreisel from Australian National University, and then with Professor Kiyoshi Kojima from Japan, were those who are crucial for bringing intellectual foundations of APEC. They were then testifying in front of Congress, etc. So thanks to him, to this fantastic scholarly atmosphere at Columbia, I got interested in the broader Asia-Pacific. Then I graduated here, started my PhD, and had a chance to go to School of International Relations and Pacific Studies at the University of California in San Diego. Officially being connected, I've graduated from Global Leadership Institute, where I was connected with APEC Study Center at UCSD, with Professor Richard Feinberg as the director of this APEC Study Center. He himself was more interested in sub-regional integration. It was integration between Americas on one hand, FTAA, Free Trade Area of Americas, was important, still important issue at that time, but also ASEAN. So I've broadened my horizons, I would say, a bit beyond American foreign policy, including multilateral relations, into sub-regional integration in Asia. And this is more or less what brought me to the topic then. Again, I had a chance to start my research in Asia. I spent very, very fruitful time at Institute of Southeast Asian Studies in Singapore. For the first time, I went there in 2008. At that time, I had the chance to do my research at APEC Secretariat, so APEC headquarters in Singapore, as well as ASEM Asia Europe Foundation, being the only physical emanation of this trans-regional cooperation between Europe and Asia, so ASEM. Then I had the chance to do my research in other Asian Studies centers. I was in Korea Institute for International Economic Policy for the first time in Seoul last year, 2017. I visited this institute already in the new capital or future capital of South Korea, in Sejong City. Mm-hmm. Then I went to CSIS in Jakarta, to Waseda University, and some other institutes in the region, including also Canberra, Australian National University, and East Asia Bureau for Economic Research, led by Professor Peter Dreisel, so the second founding father of APEC. All of this gave me a picture of this very lively, very intensified research ongoing in the topic of Asia-Pacific integration that to some extent is still underestimated in Europe, I would say. As the Asian Studies Center in Europe is growing, but the US is far more advanced in this research, and this was the reason I focused my research and my academic career on
so
the
could you tell me in terms of your most recent publication, the Pacific Century, the title is pretty much self-explanatory, that you assume that the global power is shifting towards Southeast Asia region. Is that the case? What's your main assumption in this book?
Yeah, so definitely what you've correctly mentioned. The global center of power has been shifting towards Asia Pacific, and I've been working on this issue, writing about it, not only in the book you've mentioned, but also in some papers, including reference to certain IR theories, and the competition we may observe, or we've been observing for the last 20 years at least. It's been a competition between the United States and China. Some scholars naturally awareness. It's been a problem. It's been a serious challenge for the United States. And if there is a difficult period in relations between the United States and China, like the Taiwan Strait crisis in the mid-90s, 1995, 1996, we read books, we can find books in both sides of the Pacific, stressing the problem, the possible conflict. In the US at that time, there were books of Timberlake, Triplett, Bernstein, Monroe, wording against or wording US-China can be a risk. In China, there was a famous book, China can say no to this American imperialist policy. But then we've got a calm period of collaboration. However, there is no doubt Chinese relative power has been growing in comparison to American power. And if we refer to it, we can again find some people who are clearly warning against Chinese growth. Others, for instance, John Mersheimer, the leading theoretician of offensive realism, who's been stressing the fact that US should collaborate closely with the European Union and with Russia in order to contain rising China. And to some extent it would fit the theory called power transition theory created by Abraham Morganski and Jacek Kugler.
But isn't that there is no agreement among the realists that China is actually growing so fast? For instance, Zbigniew Brzeziński, he in late 90s, he deeply underestimated China. He recognized China, but it was in the late 2000s. He said that I was basically underestimating China. So what would be your intake on that?
Yeah, so there are two issues. Referring to Zbigniew Brzeziński, you're right, he was underestimating China, probably underestimating too much, and he knew it. Yeah. So if you look at his works, the Grand Chessboard was published in late 90s, so 20 years ago. It's been a lot of time in 2014, as I've mentioned in my last book. But, of course, referring to the data, China became the biggest economy in the world, according to IMF data. Of course, if we measure it based on PPP, purchasing power parities, and if we again refer to power transition theory, economic power at a certain stage is transformed into military power. In case of China, it's been transformed slowly. China is pretty responsible player. It's been spending more or less sustainable amount of money on its military. Currently, depending on the source, it's around $200 billion, which is around 30-35% of the US military expenditure. It's been a huge gap, definitely it's been a huge gap. And China will not acquire military power to contest American primacy pretty soon. However, within reasonable and foreseeable time, we can expect China would be able to challenge US, at least locally in sub-China Sea, locally.
Some say that it's happening already. It's like China is becoming the second largest economy in the world. It's building its air carriers and it's modernizing its army, it reinforces its nuclear arsenal. So is China a threat to US in Trans-Pacific region?
Okay, so again, as I said, it's based on this power transition theory. This would be expected way of behavior of China. China become stronger economically, as I've mentioned. It's been the first economy in the world according to PPP terms. As you've mentioned, it's the second economy in the world. If we look at real GDP, so based on exchange rates, this is transforming. It's been transforming into military. Size of the military doesn't matter so much. China has bigger military than the US. More than 2 million soldiers, 2.1, 2.25, depending on the sources again, and some calculations, who's included, who's not. The US has 1.5 million soldiers. However, of course, in the US military, civilian contractors are bigger part. There is bigger number of civilian contractors. So altogether, this military would be comparable in size. Of course, the size is pretty often counterproductive to quality of the military. And this is this was the problem China was realizing already when starting the so-called formal modernizations in 1978, Deng Xiaoping got power and initiated a program of formal modernizations in China. One of these modernizations was modernization of the military. So the number of troops was gradually reduced to around 4 million, 3 million in mid-80s current size. At the same time, or thanks to the reduction in size, it was possible to modernize, to increase the quality of the military, and the impulse apart from policy of Deng Xiaoping, who initiated the so-called military modernization in 1978, then accelerated in 1985 when he decided that nuclear confrontation is not inevitable, was accelerated again after the so-called George Bush shock, namely after the First Persian Gulf War. First Persian Gulf War showed that a pretty well-equipped traditional army of Saddam Hussein, Iraqi army of Saddam Hussein, got defeated pretty easily by Americans. And it was a modernization impulse for Chinese military, as Chinese military was similar in terms of equipment of weapons to Iraqi army rather than to American army. And Deng Xiaoping gave this advice to his successor, to Jiang Zemin, who initiated what is called, or what was called, high-tech revolution in the military. It was high-tech revolution, probably not in the sense that Americans would understand it, as less components of especially communication technology, internet technology, information technology, was introduced at the time, but again in early 21st century. Next components were going under this modernization efforts, sophisticated trainings, etc. I don't want to go into technical details here. And definitely, reduction in size by half or less allowed China to build a pretty professional army, but still far, far behind American army. However, able to introduce anti-access area defense system that makes American offensive forces less efficient in the territories surrounding China, including South China Sea, which is a disputed area with certain ASEAN countries, which especially Vietnam and the Philippines. So this definitely is a challenge for the US. As you've mentioned, new types of weaponry, including aircraft carriers or carrier, this is to a large extent a fake. Yeah? So there is an aircraft carrier, it's mostly used for training and to demonstrate China has it. But its value, its usefulness in other battlefield would be close to zero.
Okay, so but for this moment, this thesis, would you not say that these same thesis would be elaborated against Russia and Admiral Kuznetsov and the airship carrier which was used in recent battle of Aleppo, and it has proven to be quite instrumental in defeating al-Nusra, Free Syrian Army, and well, ISIS to a certain extent. And this carrier wasn't of great shape. Russia basically pulled it from the Northern Sea to Mediterranean and it used it. So China has this type of air carrier within its military and it can build much more than one. According to recent information, China is in the process of building at least four of air carriers. So wouldn't that constitute a threat?
I don't have doubts China will be able to use aircraft carriers. China would be able to project its power to open waters. However, at the moment, China is not able to increase its power projection capabilities by using the aircraft carrier it's been possessing. So it will happen. It's pretty costly. If you observe how the US was developing technology of its aircraft carrier production, the last aircraft carrier that I think is still not commissioned, it's in the testing phase, George Herbert Bush, this is a new type of carrier, was built by like 20 years, I think something like this.
And they have a strong tradition of building air carriers. It started long before the Second World War, so China is long behind. So I could agree with that completely.
So I can expect around 2030, 2035, China would be able to increase power projection capabilities beyond the so-called green waters into blue waters. Because apart from having even aircraft carriers, they should also have logistics capabilities, logistical capabilities to provide support for this type of vessels, naval vessels. Yes, an aircraft carrier is useless or is relatively vulnerable without all those accompanying ships, all the group, etc. So we have a lot of challenges China has been facing, and in maritime capabilities, China is relatively backwarded. It's been doing better in other types of military that you've mentioned, especially intercontinental ballistic missiles 20 years ago, and 20 years is not long in terms of military technology, it's a very short period despite of what we normally think. China has had mostly liquid-fueled ICBMs and started developing of this DF-5, DF-31, so Dongfeng, DF-31, missiles that are solid-fueled missiles. Currently, this is an important part of their arsenal, making it much less vulnerable for being destructed. So here we observe pretty substantial progress. Finally, as for ground forces, China has been traditionally doing pretty well. And for air forces, it's been trying to develop it, especially with this new fifth generation fighters. But again, it seems for the moment, it's rather a training for both constructors and the pilots than the real tool for especially aggressing Susu, fighting with someone as an aggressor.
Professor Grabowski, you're obviously an expert in Asia and transatlantic, trans-Pacific relations. Could you tell me whether you would agree that basically China these days switches from hard power to soft power?
Despite of what we normally hear, China has been leaning towards soft power for a pretty long time. And I would say around 20 years, it's been around 20 years. However, it used these tools already in early 90s. So it would be almost 30 years. As China realized that international public opinion or international community influences chances for CCP, Chinese Communist Party survival to a large extent. If I want to tell the story, after Tiananmen massacre of June 1989, as you remember, China became a pariah of international community. Sanctions were imposed on China by European countries, by Japan, by the United States. next 3 years meant a drastic drop in Chinese GDP growth. It was not like there was negative growth. Chinese economy was still growing in 1990, 1991, 1992. However, much slower than before and much slower than later. And China started to search a way to get back to international community. And it used soft power tools already at the time. One of these tools was not vetoing UN resolution allowing international coalition to intervene in Iraq in the first Persian Gulf War. Another was brokering a peace process in Cambodia that led to Paris Peace Accord of 1991. Then we had a period of hesitation, and because China has been hesitating between soft and hard power, maybe it is what's defined by Jozef Nice smart power, but I wouldn't go so far. Yes, it's rather hesitation between soft power and hard power. In mid-90s, China was focused more on being assertive, especially against a possible Taiwanese independence. China was pretty assertive in the South China Sea in mid-90s. But then China realized there is a chance for this country to increase its position in Southeast Asia. This chance was naturally Asian economic crisis. Asian economic crisis led to drastic drop of American position in the region. The US was the country that blocked Japanese initiative of Asian Monetary Fund creation. This initiative was consulted with South Korea, with Japan, with China, by Japanese authorities at the time. And the US opposed it strongly during APEC meeting in Vancouver. IMF opposed it strongly. So Southeast Asian countries that were mostly affected by Asian financial crisis, especially Indonesia, the Philippines, and Thailand, could of course agree on IMF conditions, and they did so. Malaysia had run a little bit different policy. Mahathir bin Mohamad was rather not accepting these conditions of IMF. It frozen capital outflow, convertibility of ringgit, etc. But those three countries were especially affected, and China was the country that assisted them by providing cheap loans, by not devaluating yuan, but by providing, to a certain extent, ODA, official development assistance. It was a moment when China got stronger position, and institution called ASEAN plus 3 was formed, so 10 ASEAN countries, China, Japan, and Korea started to meet. They started financial cooperation, like Chiang Mai initiative was initiated at that time. This was a set of bilateral swap agreements. Then Asian bond market initiative was created, and economic review and policy dialogue. This financial economic investments led to increasing China's position, but at the same time it had problem in South China Sea. So China decided to start a more conciliatory approach. And in 2002, China, together with ASEAN countries, signed declaration of conduct of parties in the South China Sea, renouncing the use of force. In 2005, oil companies from the Philippines, Vietnam, and China signed an agreement about joint exploration and exploitation of resources from Spratly Islands or Archipelago. So it was a moment when China built in both dimensions, in economic dimension, it built soft power, and in political dimension. Of course, China has been attracting other countries in the region by its economic model for a long time, even longer than I mentioned here. Dai Moyin reforms in Vietnam that started in 1986 were to some extent following reforms of Deng Xiaoping. And in China, even though Vietnam and China were enemies and still are at the different sides, let's say Vietnam is.
It's much easier from the perspective of China to cooperate with southern countries and ASEAN group because these countries are much more open. How about North Korea?
Okay, so just referring briefly to Southeast Asia, China has been collaborating, but we should remember that US has still been playing a bigger role in IR in the region than China. Yeah, US has a very good partnership relations with treaty allies such as Thailand and the Philippines, with some hesitations, of course, when Rodrigo Duterte became Philippinian president in 2016, but shortly after US elected Donald Trump, and with Donald Trump, Rodrigo Duterte felt very good energy, so the Philippines were back to US, let's say, sphere of influence. Then Vietnam has been anti-Chinese since virtually the 60s, I would say, especially since 70s, and even more after the Sino-Vietnamese War of 1979. So it's pro-American. Naturally, Singapore would be pro-American. Malaysia has been hesitating, so depending on the period. Burma or Myanmar, Laos and Cambodia are definitely pro-Chinese countries. However, US has been doing a lot to collaborate closer with Burma after this democratic transformation process started. So, coming back to North Korea. So it's not so obvious in Southeast Asia. And China has been investing a lot in terms of money, in terms of political issues, but at the same time, depending on the period, there is this big conflict over Third China Sea. And it's been a problem in relations between especially ASEAN countries and China. In North Korea, the situation seems pretty obvious. And China was a natural leader of North Korea. The Soviet Union was a natural leader as well for some time. North Korea was doing pretty well economically, as you may know, in early 60s, in 62, comparison of GDP between North Korea and South Korea would definitely give prevalence to North Korea.
Not anymore.
In 62, GDP per capita in North Korea was twice bigger than in South Korea. Currently, South Korean GDP would be 100 times bigger, than North Korea, more or less 100-120 times bigger. So this shows us the difference. But gradually in the 60s, in the 70s, support both from Soviet Union and from China was more and more limited. This was one of the reasons Kim Il-sung, the then leader of Korea, announced the idea of Juche, meaning self reliance in political, economic, and military terms. So Juche was not the name of Kim Il-sung, as some people were saying. And since then, relations between Korea and China, they were friendly, they were positive. But definitely, they were not as close as we normally imagine. In 1992, China started its diplomatic relations, established diplomatic relations with South Korea. And North Koreans, Kim Il-sung himself, were perceiving it as a betrayal. At the same time, China was still investing in North Korea. And it was trying to encourage North Korean authorities to start a model known from China, model of special economic zones. In the meantime, there was the death of Kim Il-sung in 1994. It was a very difficult period for North Korea, as you know. They were experiencing droughts leading to extreme hunger in the country, being still supported by South Korea. And if you look at late 90s, support from South Korea was bigger than support from China. China was doing business with North Korea to some extent, but not supporting this country, not supporting this dictator. Then, if you look at Kim Jong-il, he was pretty open to collaboration with South Korea and accepted this initiative of Kim Dae-jung, initiative known as Sunshine Policy. Sunshine Policy became viable, became popular when in the year 2000 there was first inter-Korean summit. Kim Dae-jung met Kim Jong-il. It led to a series of bilateral projects. Huge economic complex was created in Kaesong in North Korea. The South Korean managers, Hyundai is the most important investor, and North Korean workers working. There were also some projects of family connections, tourist projects on Kukulka, trans-border railways or roads, famous stores and stations was built, etc., etc. So set of initiatives started. South Korea experienced long-lasting period of totalitarian or authoritarian government, and when it democratized at the turn of 80s and 90s, in order to prevent long ruling presidents, South Korea decided there will be only one term available allowed for the president. So Kim Dae-jung term was over pretty soon. His successor, Moo-hyun, was continuing this policy of getting closer to North Korea, policy known as peace and prosperity then. But successor of Kim Dae-jung, Lee Myung-bak, started to play much harsher policy, started to implement much harsher policy towards North Korea, and it made relations unstable. As you know, there was a time of second nuclear test in 2009, and then subsequent tests, missile tests, maritime confrontation next to Yongpyeongdong, Yongpyeong Islands. In 2010, South Korean ship was sunk by North Korean torpedo. 46, as far as I remember, sailors were killed in this catastrophe, in this incident. So relations deteriorated. And again, there was no choice for Korea but to search for Chinese assistance. China was interested, and it's still been interested, in playing an important role in North Korea. This is important if China doesn't want unified Korea dominated by Americans. Yeah, but this is the issue. If you look at South Korea in early 21st century, South Koreans didn't want it either, because they perceived George Walker Bush as an obstacle against North Korean unification. So China and Chinese and South Koreans' points of view were similar. China was, of course, as I said, building collaborating relations with North Korea. And there was a lot of economic initiatives coordinated by Jang Sung-taek. Jang Sung-taek was an uncle of a current leader, Kim Jong-un, and as you know, he was executed shortly after Kim Jong-un became a leader of North Korea. The reasons are hard to understand on the one hand from European point of view, but are easy to understand if we think about this dynastic policy. He was a threat to young leader. He was the second strongest person in the government. He was controlling the military. But he was also the person Chinese investors knew to bribe. Yeah, so if they were thinking whom to bribe, they were thinking about Jang Song-taek. And after Jang Song-taek was executed, the kind of bribery vacuum appeared, if I can call it so. There were, Chinese would say, Guangxi connections. There were no Guangxi in North Korea. So for some time, there was a problem in bilateral economic cooperation. It's been rebuilding right now. As you know, China has been the biggest importer, especially of coal from North Korea. And China is pretty ambivalent in terms of sanctions. Yeah, so Donald Trump is asking Xi Jinping to impose sanctions, and China to some extent has been doing so, because having unpredictable nuclear power at its border is a challenge for China as well. And at the same time, having growing number of people trying to migrate to leave North Korea, crossing Yalu River and getting to China, it's been also a problem. Yeah? So for China, stability in North Korea would be beneficial, as China has been pressing North Korea to behave more properly in international environment. Of course, some analysts would say, does say, that North Korean leaders behave pretty rationally. Yeah? So when they faced problems with possible defense against the United States, so it was before they tested nuclear weapons, they were trying to play the negotiations game. And China, of course, was engaged. It was initiator of six-party talks in 2003. Then, after 2006, they become more assertive. And this is in order to get more financial support from the West. I would say the results are counterproductive for the moment, and the rationality of North Korea is doubtful. It is understandable in terms of possession of nuclear weapons. North Korea should have nuclear weapons, because observing what happened in Libya after closing its nuclear program, or observing situation in Iraq, North Koreans were afraid that being part of axis of evil would lead to possible destruction of their country. Yeah? So in this respect, this is rational policy. On the other hand,
Kenneth Waltz once said that Iran should acquire nuclear weapons as well, so it will be more predictable. And there is a strong line of comparison between North Korea and Iran. Could you comment on that possibly?
Apart from the fact that China and North Korea to some extent were collaborating with Iran, yeah, because of acquiring oil and selling weapons, there is kind of similarity as to both countries were running a nuclear program. North Korea was situated among countries that are more peaceful. Iran had Israel close to it. And Israel was trying to stop Iranian nuclear program. As you know, there was some actions against scholars working in Iran. There was famous computer virus that again hampered nuclear program of Iran. In case of North Korea, they managed to acquire nuclear weapons, and now they're relatively safe. Mm-hmm. So we shouldn't expect first strike of external country on North Korea, because the response may include nuclear response, so it would be too dangerous. If we look at Iran, this is difficult situation. Yeah. If Iran would be a subject of foreign aggression, it has no tools to defend itself in a non-conventional way. For the moment, at the time of Barack Obama, it was safe. No, Barack Obama was happy with the deal, nuclear deal with Iran. Donald Trump has a different approach, and this is risky. So, being part of authorities of Iran, I would consider continuing the program. Of course, calculate what is better, what is not. Is it cheaper? Of course, there were many international sanctions, etc., etc. So, with the predictability of the actors in the system, we believe that all great powers or important players in the system are predictable. So US will not start a war with Iran without a reason, legitimate reason.
There is the presidents such as George W. Bush, who would be unpredictable, and Donald Trump has a reputation of being a little bit unpredictable. Although he's not hawkish, or he's not considered to be a warmonger. So, unpredictability of American foreign policy met with unpredictability of North Korea and Iran, we can have a huge, mess in Asian politics. Or would you disagree?
We could. However, I don't expect US to act unpredictably. Mm-hmm. Despite of Donald Trump declarations, observing American foreign policy, Asian policy, in the last decades, we could see similar behavior, similar declarations of many presidents. However, in reality, they were not willing to engage in hot conflict. Bill Clinton was warning North Korea, was analyzing an option to bomb Yongbyon nuclear facilities. George Walker Bush, even though he was aggressive, had relatively positive relations also with countries that were mentioned, were called competitors of the US, especially China. Barack Obama had pretty good relations to Donald Trump. Despite his very strong rhetorics, like anti-Chinese rhetorics, in political and military terms, is trying to have very good constructive relations with the region. A playing unpredictable person may be a good approach towards Kim Jong-un. However, I doubt, certain circumstances, Donald Trump could be another bad guy in the room, and then unfortunately we go into a dangerous game, chicken game, I think it was called. But at the same time, I don't expect Donald Trump to neglect his advisors to this extent that we don't have predictability in the system. If you look at the people who are running Pacific Command, who are running Bureau of Assistant Secretary of Defense for Asia and Pacific Affairs, etc., they're relatively responsible, high quality people. So I don't expect dramatic change in this situation. Of course, black swans happen, and then we can expect some change, even not expecting it.
Shall we add to the equation also Russia, China, and USA, this three the most important countries in the global structure of power.
Of course, six-party talks negotiations initiated in 2003 were a joint initiative of the US, Japan, China, and Russia, and two Koreas, of course. China played a dominant role. Russia was a big perceived as a supporter of North Korea, but didn't necessarily play this role. Russia started its pivot to Asia at the time of Vladimir Putin, long before the US announced it. As in the 90s, Russia was westward oriented, so Zapadniki Westerners were dominating foreign policy planning process in Russia, if there was any policy planning process, especially in late 90s. Vladimir Putin started to surge influence in the Asia-Pacific. And if we look at Vladimir Putin, he was quite successful, but we have to remember that Russia has pretty limited resources in the Asia-Pacific. It's not like during the Cold War, when the danger from China, especially in the 80s till 86 more or less, had 25, I think, divisions deployed in the Far East. It was extremely costly. And so the number of troops was reduced. 6 to 8 million Russians is living in the Pacific area of Russia. This is more or less a number
of
people.
Out of 142 million, that's very little.
This number is comparable to Hong Kong or Singapore. Yeah, so you can imagine that number of people that should be associated with Pacific Russia, if I can use this expression, is limited. However, Putin wanted to play a role in the region, and he was participating in the first East Asia Summit meeting in Kuala Lumpur as a guest. Russia was not a member at the time. And then Vladivostok, it was a pretty successful initiative. And he collaborated in some initiatives with China's Shanghai Five in 1996, Shanghai Cooperation Organization 2001, is the transformation of Shanghai Five. Then certain initiatives, China's initiatives, like BRICS, like Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. Finally, after sanctions resulting from Russian aggression on the Crimean Peninsula in 2014, Russia signed a set of agreements with China. At the same time, geopolitically, historically, Russia and China are competing for, as two continental powers, they're competing for resources in Central Asia. Russia has been losing its monopolistic position, and as I've mentioned, there are more or many challenges for those countries. In history, they were of course competing. They were afraid of each other. Yes, Russia was afraid of China. That's why they wanted to build this Baikal-Amur railway. Well, that was one of the reasons, northern to Trans-Siberian railway. In the 90s, there was a yellow scare in Russia, as some scholars and politicians were announcing this 1.5 million Chinese already in Russian Far East, which would be one-fourth, one-fifth of total population in the region. And of course, this is pretty attractive alternative for China or for Chinese in Heilongjiang province, the northern province of China. Almost 40 million people are living in, as I said, Russian Far East, 6-8 million. So a lot of land that China could use wisely is there. But the question is whether Russia plays a constructive role. I don't think Russia is strong enough
to influence the region. It's been rather used by China than being the player. Yeah? It's been rather played. If you look at all the Sino-Russian initiatives, they were somehow associated with the weakness of China. Yeah? So after Tiananmen sanctions, Jiang Zemin and Boris Yeltsin started collaboration in nuclear and military sectors. Actually, Deng already started it, Jiang Zemin continued it. In 1996, after Taiwan Strait crisis, China had problem. Jiang met Yeltsin and they announced the doctrine of multilateral or multipolar world, yeah, to oppose the US dominance. Then Bush and his policy towards Taiwan was inspiring China again to collaborate closer with Russia, etc. So I would say that China, and at the same time, China was increasing its position in Central Asia at the cost, at the expense of Russia. Yeah? So in this respect, Russia is a minor player, and indeed, its population is 10 times smaller than population of China. Its military, it's maybe comparable. It's smaller in size, but in quality, it's comparable. Of course, excluding nuclear arsenal, Russia has nuclear triad.
Professor Grabowski, do you think that because of the recent events in Ukraine, the West actually has pushed Russia towards Southeast Asia, towards the Pacific, because Russia has realized that, well, maybe we don't fit to West, to Western Europe, and we need to change our position towards the countries that actually understand us? And would you think that it's actually this 2014, 2015 or 16 which actually gave boost to this trying Primakov doctrine?
So, Russia indeed was to some extent searching for a place where it could develop, but the problem in expansion in the Far East is everybody wants to expand there, and traditionally Russia had some good partners in Asia. Mostly it was India, as you may remember. During the Cold War, Soviet Union was collaborating with India, and China and Pakistan were collaborating with the United States, especially in the late 70s, the 80s. In terms of military acquisitions, military purchases, India still been a very important partner of Russia. It's been purchasing a lot of weapons. Southeast Asia, it's been hesitating. However, Russia is playing pretty minor role there. Of course, it engaged in collaboration with ASEAN. It's a partner of ASEAN. It's a part of East Asia Summit starting in 2011, so 6 years after it was created together with the US, it joined. It's been engaged in some regional initiatives like BRICS, BRIC Bank, or AIIB, Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. In both cases, it's either controlled by China, AIIB, or of minor importance in terms of Southeast Asian initiatives. So Russia has been playing a relatively minor role. If we look at Northeast Asia, definitely a scale of collaboration, economic collaboration between Russia and China increased dramatically in this last couple of years, mostly because of this huge gas contract. But at the same time, this is success for Russia. It has guaranteed itself a big demand for gas. And the failure, because price reportedly is much lower than Russia expected. If we look at other forms of collaboration, other forms of Russian engagement in the Far East or East Asia Southeast Asia, Northeast Asia, South Asia. I don't see an important change in especially in these parts of the world. Of course, Russia is trying to keep to build and reinforce its position in Central Asia by, for instance, Eurasian Economic Union. But again, it's facing Chinese competition, and this Chinese competition was visible in the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. This Chinese competition was visible in Central Asia energy policy. Before, Russia was a monopolist in the region. After 2009-2010, there are pipelines from Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan to China, and there is a duopoly, not a monopoly any longer. So Russia is losing rather its influence than increasing it. Therefore, I wouldn't say that this pivot to Asia has been successful for Russia. Of course, Russia has no choice. Of course, to some extent, it moved towards Asia. But I don't think Russians themselves, and President Putin especially, have this in mind. Yeah? So I would say that Putin is still westward oriented, even though temporarily not understood, yeah, from his point of view, or simply playing not according to the rules and being punished for it. For Russia, I think it would be more beneficial to collaborate with the West than with
So with how East. About Japan and China? Which one of these two can be an answer to our problems with North Korean behavior?
Oh, definitely it's China.
Definitely China.
Japan has a very minor role in the region. Japan is inward oriented in terms of military. Of course, after Shinzo Abe reinterpretation of Article 9, Japan can use its self-defense forces in collective self-defense. However, it doesn't change the situation too much. Japan is trying to maintain informal diplomatic relations with North Korea, mostly because of all those historical issues, including abductees, Japanese abductees in North Korea. Japan is trying to get back their families, also families born in Korea, and in this respect they're collaborating. But generally the role is absolutely minimal. So China is the only country that can influence North Korea, and China is the country that can provide solution for North Korean challenge. We should remember North Korea has been surprisingly doing pretty well economically in the last 5-6 years. And again, to a certain extent, it's thanks to China, thanks to the fact that China has been consuming a lot of North Korean coal especially. And current sanctions are a threat to North Korea.
I have just one last question, if I may. The question, what do you think China is the key to resolving North Korea, North Korean issue, but isn't that Japan has bigger motivation because it's actually above Japanese citizens' heads, all of these rockets that are flying, and China might not be happy to help Japan, considering their relationship, bilateral relation.
Japan has bigger motivation, but no means. So if you have no means to solve the issue, you cannot can't do too much. China can influence North Korea by conducting either assertive policy. Not necessarily China would like to do it in the long run to support Trump in North Korea. There's no reason for it. Or supporting gradual transformation of initially economic model of North Korea. And Kim Jong-un seems to be interested in such a scenario to transform North Korean economy based on Chinese example. This would be classical use of soft power. Yeah, you're attractive to others, even though others is North Korea in this respect. Being attractive it's always something that increases your soft power.
Thank you very much for this interview, Professor Grabowski. It has been a pleasure, and I wish you all the best from all the readers of Insight on Ascending. And hope to see you soon as well.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Pietrzak. It was a pleasure for me. And
thank you.